Chester, let's talk about geopolitics here. You have a fresh Singaporean Prime Minister, Lawrence Wong, coming into the fray. You also have Indonesian President Joko Widodo, the leader of ASEAN's biggest economy, making an exit. It's going to be his last ASEAN summit before Prabowo Subianto takes the presidency of Indonesia in November. How do you expect these changes in ASEAN leaders to affect discussions when it comes to the South China Sea issue in the ASEAN summit?
We have to accept the fact that there are changing leaderships in the region. And we have to understand also that transitions are very important to sustain democracy in the region. And I think given that, of course, we have the support coming from a socialist country like Vietnam forged a defense cooperation agreement with us this year. And then Singapore and Indonesia, two of the biggest economies in Southeast Asia, would want to forge also the same military pact with us, meaning to say that they are seeing the importance of the Philippines in its maritime rules-based order. And at the same time, we advocate and these international laws when, in fact, many of the countries here are also affected with the maritime insecurities. Remember that Indonesia is the largest archipelago in the world, and in Singapore, you have the Malacca Strait. So whatever happens in the West Philippine Sea / South China Sea will have an impact to their seas and the coastal waters. So meaning to say, these are very important developments right now in Southeast Asia, where some commentators are saying that they see polarization in the region. But at the same time, we are seeing some changes in terms of how we cooperate internally amongst member states. The mere fact that Vietnam, Singapore, and Indonesia are signifying their intent of cooperation with the Philippines, that means that it says a lot that ASEAN can be unified, and we're hoping that we will come up with a strong position later on when it comes to our contention in the West Philippine Sea.
Right. Chester, I forgot to say that Thailand also has a new prime minister. Right. So when looking at the composition of the current heads of state of the Southeast Asian nations, would you say that we now have more leaders who are leaning towards China, or do we have a roster that is more in favor of actually upholding the rule of law in the South China Sea?
Well, that's an interesting question, because of course many of the ASEAN countries where we have now new leaders from these important neighbors that we have are playing the game of the risking and independent foreign policy or non-alignment in terms of other engagements with bigger nations like China and the United States. And since China money is outpouring also in the region, that means that we cannot get rid of that relevance, that some other neighbors still need that. So they have to really safeguard their cooperation and partnerships with China on that matter. But you see also the dynamism of their engagements, because they try to split military from economic and not combine it, in which case for the Philippines, since we are locked with our treaty alliance with the United States, and we have a strategic problem with China because of the contention in the West Philippine Sea, we are, in a diplomatic way, we are confronted with this kind of strategic dilemma, which our neighbors are enjoying such freedom on how they would engage with China and the United States. And I think this is also a lesson learned for us, especially that ASEAN is evolving now. It is now ruled and governed by young leaders with new vision. And we see that ASEAN is going to be a major player today and in the future in the Indo-Pacific region. If we come up with some best resolutions on how to engage with this hegemonic rivalry between China and the United States and come up with our own ASEAN strategic outlook on how to resolve insecurities in the region, that would be achievable and recommendable. Given that, of course, there is a changing landscape on the leadership in the Southeast Asian region. So we are hoping that our friends from ASEAN, given that they have a fresh outlook on how they would see security landscape and architecture in the region, would come up with new solutions on how to elevate the importance of ASEAN in the world.
All right, we will have to wait and see how these new leaders would actually perform during the upcoming ASEAN Summit in the Lao People's Democratic Republic. Thank you so much for making time for us this morning. Security analyst Chester Cabalza.
Thank you very much, Ms. Scott.